Hang on to your seats, because we have a guest speaker who's going to blow your mind. He's a missionary. He's been doing this for 30 years. And this, I know for a fact, this gentleman is real. He is absolutely genuine. And he's an author, radio teacher, founder, and president of Gospel for Asia. And now when I said that, you probably already know who he is. I know this church is mission-minded. As a matter of fact, as you walk out these doors, if you look up on top, it says, as you walk out these doors, you're in the mission field. Yeah, there you go. Amen to that. And so he's here speaking. That's Gospel for Asia. Those of you who don't know, it's an organization involved in evangelism and church planting in the unreached regions of Asia. This organization supports over 16,000 church planters in the heart of the 1040 window. So please join me in welcoming K.P. Youhannan.
Good morning, good afternoon, whatever. I am not going to preach very long because I want to go to In and Out hamburger shop. I accept all invitations I get from California, especially wherever they have In and Out. We've been telling them forever, come to Dallas, Texas. That's where we are, and they have not obeyed the Lord yet. But it's a blessing to come back here. A couple of times I've been here. Anyone remember me? Would you raise your hand? All right. A lot of good friends. Tony, one of our brothers from the office, and myself, we came yesterday and this afternoon to go back to Dallas. We have some 160 some people that serve the Lord with us on the staff with Gospel for Asia. We always look for people who are willing to leave their home, California, wherever, and IT people, computer people, TV people, all kind of people who want to serve the Lord with us. And so if you are someone who is thinking about giving your life to serve the Lord on the behalf of 2 billion people that do not know the Lord, please think about us. Go to our website, gfa.org, gospelforasia.org, because the Orissa crisis is very huge. Over 4,000 Christians' homes were completely destroyed during this past 2 months. And, a couple of hundred churches were destroyed. I mean, can you imagine you go home today and somebody burned your house down and the reason is you are a Christian. And Sunday you come back to worship here, the entire building is gone because this is a church. And those of us who live here don't realize that some 14,000 people get killed every year around the world for their faith in Christ. And the price they pay is very high. And it's a good thing to ask, if situation like that comes upon us here, how will you respond to it? And Jesus said, you don't wait for the flood and the rain to start building a foundation or a house on the foundation. So we better understand the reality of the world we are living in and be sober and serious about our commitment to Christ. Information about spirituality is not going to sustain you. Some authenticity and reality we need on the inside. That's what's going to keep us going in these last days. We have a couple of things I want to mention to you before I read some scripture verses. Some years ago, the Lord impressed upon our hearts to open our base in Dallas for young people to come and spend a year with us. It's a discipleship school. We call it Road to Reality Internship. Young people who finish their high school, they can take a year and come and be with us. And part of the time, we send them overseas. And of course, after the year, they go back to their churches, their college, and whatever. But it's happening. There is such a tremendous hunger on the hearts of young people to understand godliness and become authentic. And you become spiritual not by reading about it, but being with people who model that. You learn about prayer and fasting not by learning about it, but being with people who pray. Every Friday, first Friday of the month, we have all-night prayer. Start in the evening, 8 o'clock, goes till 5, 6 in the morning. And so you say, what do you pray about? Well, come and join us. If you are a young person or if you are parents, you are thinking about kicking your kids out of your home, they're a nuisance, pick up one of these or go to our website. And I assure you, the other day I was talking to our young people right now in internship in Dallas. They were telling me, you know, their lives are totally revolutionized within a few months' time. I said, how did that happen? They said, well, we are taught, but more so, we live with people who actually are serious about following the Lord. So I want to encourage you to think about that. Okay, I want to read to you something. You got one of the best pastors in the whole world and Bible teacher. Yeah, you do. You do. And therefore, I don't think I should be taking time to teach you Greek and Hebrew. He does very well. But listen to these words, please. A shift seems to be taking place in the reflections of men and women on godliness and knowing God. There is a growing awareness that external things, materialism, superficial experience, worldly success, are not what our spirits long for, nor will be ever be truly satisfied with them. Rather, our spirits long after spiritual realities that will not be quenched with mere words or correct doctrines and the truth without life. The current Christianity, which for most part is based on self, has lost its ability to influence society and be what God truly intended. Instead of living simple, devout, quiet and godly lives, like salt and light permeate in the society, the church has too often turned to worldly, fleshly and carnal means to effect change. Yet, in the midst of this confusion and darkness, these brave souls are seeking for deeper healing through humility and godliness. They are discovering that an independent spirit and avoidance of pain and suffering are not the means to find that life abundant. Their spirits thirst for the living God as a deer pants for the stream, and they will not be satisfied until they drink from the fountain of living water. Those are few paragraphs from the book, Touching Godliness Through Submission, and that's the introduction. 4 years ago, I have authored over 200 books, and it was 4 years ago during a week of prayer and waiting upon God, the Lord spoke to me about something very significant. He said, you know, my people at large don't understand me, nor do they touch godliness, because they are independent, they're proud, they're arrogant, they will not break or bend. And that set me on a search for the scripture and seek the Lord deeply about it, because I'm part of a movement where we have nearly 2 million baptized believers, the fruit of our ministry over 30 years in 11 nations. And they look to me as their spiritual leader and shepherd. So I am consumed not with American Christianity and pastors here, but we have some 10,000 pastors that I am responsible for, their father in faith. So the search for understanding of God's, you know, speaking in my heart led me to teach these principles for 500 leaders from different countries of the world, and the fruit was so huge, and our leaders in the United States said, you know, we need to put this in writing. So this book came out after 4 years of journey, and it is called Touching Godliness Through Submission. Let me say this to you. You will really never understand God and the Lord's ways unless you come to the place of being totally broken and submissive. Submissive to God and to people God placed over you. The seriousness is more than our culture wants us to understand. From the day we are born, we are told, this is my toy, this is my room, this is my blanket, don't touch it. And we teach our kids, you are 16, you are on your own. And we, after all the years of learning the Bible, we remain shallow. far away from understanding godliness. And for some of you, I know what I tell you, you understand it because you walked on this road. So I'm not trying to sell this book. Of course, you know, any money that comes from any of my books, I don't get one penny out of it. It all goes to the Lord's work. So I plead with you to get a copy of it. They printed 5,000 copies. Within a couple of months, they all ran out because people are buying 100 copies, 50 copies to give away to people. And some pastor wrote and said he want every family in the congregation to read this book. I think it cost $8, something like that, but you can get a copy in the table back there. But another book which I think you must read if you are planning to go to heaven. That is Revolution World Missions. How many of you got a copy of this? Would you raise your hand? Wow, thank you. Get a copy. I think it's free also for you to get from here, whatever, and 2 million copies in print, but you can buy this also if you want to pay money for that. All right, so there we are. You understand my English?
Yes.
You know, sometimes I get confused. You know, I'm not one, you know, telling jokes before I teach. That's not my way. But once in a while, I get some funny stuff. People send it to me. It's really amazing. Now, listen to this. A minister was completing a temperance sermon. That means he was preaching against drinking. Okay? He must have been a Baptist preacher, I'm sure. With great emphasis, he said, "If I had all the beer in the world, I would take it and pour it into the river." With even great emphasis, he said, "If I had all the wine in the world, I would take it and pour it into the river." And then finally, shaking his fists in the air, he said, "And if I had all the whiskey in the world, I would take it and pour it into the river." Sermon complete, he sat down. The song leader stood up very cautiously and announced with a smile, nearly laughing, "For our closing song, let us sing hymn 365, Shall We Gather at the River?" I think it really happened in the Baptist church. Okay, please turn your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke. Gospel according to Luke. Chapter 14. Verse 25. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple." Obviously, Christ had thousands of people following him for miracles, for healing, for learning great mystical truths. He was known as a teacher. But the Lord looked at them and he realized not all of them were serious about following him. You see, Jesus didn't need somebody to go and tell him, "Jesus, this guy's a creep. Don't trust him." He knew the hearts of all people. He didn't pick any individual by name, but he simply spoke these words, knowing that the multitude that followed him, only minority really took him serious and wanted to be his disciples. So he said, "If you want to be mine, if you want to follow me and be my disciple, this is what you should do. You know, you should love me. Your affection for me and the priority you place on me must be more than father, mother, son, daughter." And I wish he stopped there. He didn't. "Even your own very life." And, you know, sometimes maybe it's good we drop the word Christians. Are you a Christian? Just don't ask that. It's good to ask, are you a disciple of Christ? Are you a follower of the Lord? It is a lifelong, consistent, perpetual journey of an individual following in the footsteps of the living Christ. It is not following a bunch of doctrines or denomination or traditions. Rather, it is the living Christ. And when you follow him, what happens? You become like him. You know, the old covenant, it is the rules and regulations. Do this, don't do this. If you do this, I'm going to get you. And all this stuff, you know, the rules and regulations. But when you come to the new covenant, it is not like that. It is, we are called to be partakers of his nature. We become like him as we follow him, and Christ's life and his nature becomes our nature. It is not that, oh, I have to be humble, so I look humble. It's not like that. Oh, I have to be honest. People expect me, so I will be honest. It's not like that. It is the Holy Spirit transforms us from inside. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. We look in the mirror, the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit help us to change into the likeness of the face we see in the mirror, which is the face of Jesus, his nature. And this is extremely significant because a lot of people think if they hear all the teaching, if they memorize all the Bible verses, if they sing the right choruses and go to church and everything is, you know, they do what is expected of them, which is a real Christian people talk about, okay, that'll be okay. But you know, the problem is that often people who've been studying the Bible for 25, 30 years, and even preachers who've been preaching and teaching for years, all of a sudden you hear about crashing their life and falling away. As a matter of fact, I must tell you, not a week go by, I don't get an email or a call from someone about some pastor, some minister, some Sunday school teacher, somebody who is falling apart. Is it because they didn't know the information? It is because they didn't understand it. It is one thing to know, it is another thing to become. As a matter of fact, some years ago, a friend of mine who was going to a fellowship had huge emphasis on teaching the Bible. And he was with them, you know, for months and three times a week, Bible study and this and that. And finally, he realized the people that he was fellowshipping with, their lives were no different than anybody else in the world. The greed, love of money, looking for power and position, status symbol, approval of men, bitterness, unforgiveness, and all the other stuff. And then he went to the Lord and said, Lord, why is it people who know so much of your word, their lives are like this? And the Lord, suppose he had spoken to his heart, he told me, the Lord said, son, they spend time with the Bible, they don't spend time with me. I'm not saying we should study the Bible. I do every day. And we must go to church and learn the word of God. But like the Pharisees who came to Jesus, who knew everything so much, they were teaching people. And Jesus, you know what? You study the Bible, you dissect it, you memorize it, you write commentaries on it, and all the stuff you do, thinking that in it you will have life, but they testify of me and you will not come to me. Following a bunch of doctrines and systems may be easier, but following Christ means we have to die to self, and our flesh don't want that. That is a problem. So here, Jesus is saying, you want to be mine? You want to be my disciple? This is what you should do. And Christ is calling us not for easy road. It's a narrow road. The Lord is looking for men and women who will not just give a few hours of the weekends or, you know, after they retire. No, I think the Lord is looking for people, those who see Christ, the Lord, the first and most important person in their life. You know, I remember talking to this young man who wanted to marry my daughter. You know, my two children, they grew up in the States, and when they finished their studies, they felt the Lord was calling them to serve the Lord on the mission field. So 18 years ago, they left still on the mission field. But when my daughter, the time, for her married, because, when we don't arrange marriage, although sometimes I think it's a good idea. We assist our children, help our children to pray through these things. Although, they made a commitment. They wouldn't go against their parents. So anyway, this young man felt that he wanted to marry my daughter. And so I was talking to him, it's a couple of years ago now. So I said, his name is Daniel. I said, please tell me about your life. What is it all about? Where are you going? What's your life about? And, because he's a medical doctor. So he said, when I was studying in school, I came to know the Lord. And when I was in college, the Lord clearly spoke to my heart to commit my life, to make him the Lord and everything in my life. And my life, I committed to serve him, and that's the whole thing is. Then he made this classic statement. He said, my vocation is I'm a medical doctor, but my call is to serve the Lord because he is my Lord. I said, all right. He got it. You passed the test. And, such a joy to see, they both serve the Lord on the mission field. We have some 53,000 kids we rescued, from the untouchables, Dalits families, giving them education, hope, and a future, and Jesus too. And they go and live among these people and serve them, and then conduct these, clinics in different parts of the country, Nepal, everywhere, where thousands of people come during the whole day, where they are able to minister and the missionaries work. And what a beautiful thing to see, that someone who sees his profession is not the Lord. It is a vocation. But the call is to serve God. So my brothers and sisters, wherever you may be, Jesus demands that you see him in and all things as you, his disciple, to live his life and demonstrate his life in this generation. But the problem often is that we don't understand it. So there is a dichotomy in our life. Sunday, we are Christians, and Monday through Saturday, we got other agendas. And what are the stipulations the Lord placed before us? I will run through this fast. One, the supreme love for Christ. Love me more than anyone, anything, and your own very life. It is easy to say, but it is not very easy to do. And, I think we'll be happy to give our parents and brothers and sisters and all these other things, but the last thing, we can't think about giving up our own little life. Especially in this culture, it's none of your business to tell me what I must do. This preacher is hard. I'm going to go to another church. They're trying to get me to do things and get my money. They're mean. They're legalistic. I hate him. Of course, Pastor Jack is a wonderful, loving man. You are in a good place. But what happens is that anything rub against our flesh and our feelings and our own ways, we immediately take an exodus and then go to some other place, just hoping from place to place, rather than saying, Lord, you're talking to me about my ways are not right. I'm willing to say no to these things because I love you. And my brothers and sisters, we blame the devil for a whole bunch of things. And the poor devil get frustrated often. No, I'm not the friend of the devil. I think the devil is mean and bad. But, the Christians are going around blaming devil for everything under the sun. And the devil is saying, what have I done to you? I didn't do anything. It's your flesh. It's you who makes these kind of choices. You don't like the cross. You don't want to follow. Christ said, why do you blame me? I remember in one meeting some years ago, somewhere in the United States, a lady came to me and said, Pastor, would you please pray for me? I said, yes. Please tell me, what is it you want me to pray for? She said, lay your hand on me and cast out the demon of smoke within me. I said, what? I said, dear lady, I can, in Jesus' name, cast out demons. but I cannot cast out the flesh. You see, we are so drunk with our own self, our own ways, that we cannot follow the Lord because we have not understood Him as the most important thing in the whole wide world. And you say, Brother KP, I heard these kind of things before, but what are you trying to get at? You see, there's a study that is released about American Christians. It said, average believers in our country here pray less than 8 minutes a day. Average pastors pray less than 12 minutes a day. You understand the problem? Think about a boy falling in love with a girl, or a girl falling in love with a boy. And the parent says, you have to come home 10 o'clock. Don't stay any longer. And the guy gets home 1 o'clock in the morning, and dad says, we waited for you. What happened to you? He says, Dad, it's only 10 o'clock. And the truth is, he killed the watch. Time went by, he just didn't even realize it. And the guy who is paying $20 a month for telephone bill, after having fallen in love with this creature, now it is $3,000 telephone bill. And he will give up the job in New York City to fly to Los Angeles, wherever this place is, Chino Hills, whatever. So he can be here with her or with him. And so, you see, you know what I'm saying? Let me ask you this, without trying to make you feel dumb and stupid. When was the last time you spent a full day with the Lord, fasting and waiting, not to get anything out of Him, not for healing and money and a job or for someone else, just for His sake? When was the last time you spent an hour with the Lord? When was the last time, quietly, secretly, you spent a week that you took off on the work, like you take a vacation for 2 weeks? The only reason is to be with Him, not for anything you can get from Him. To be intimate, to understand. You say, well, this all sounds so spooky and mystical. You know, I've been following the Lord now 40 years and serving the Lord. In the early days of my life, some older brothers told me, the most important thing in your life is to get to know the Lord and not be a great worker for Him. And it was not easy for me to spend 15 minutes with the Lord. But the more I came to know Him, the more I understood that's the most precious thing in the whole wide world. And when my son went to Nepal as a missionary, I found out he was going to go on a 7 days walk with others to a dangerous place where they could walk and people can fall over the cliff and kill themselves. And when I first heard that, I remember so well, I got mad at my leaders in Kathmandu for making the decision to send my only son on that treacherous, difficult journey. I had no problem with 300 of our Nepali missionaries going and serving God. I didn't have any problem. Rather, I was proud of one of our missionaries who one time said goodbye to his wife and his children and prayed, going to the mission field, thinking that he may never come back alive because of the danger. I was so proud of that. But when I found out, my only son, they're sending him on this trip. On the inside, I was furious. How can they do something like that to my son? Don't they know he's the only thing I have? And you're talking about a mission leader who wrote so many books and preaches all over the world. And after all my self-pity and anger and everything, the Lord just simply said, quite interesting to see how you respond to the situation. And the thing was, I said, Lord, I didn't know my heart is so ugly, so self-centered. I'm so possessed with what I want, and I love my son, and I didn't realize it is down there. It was so comforting. The Lord said, yeah, I allowed it to happen so you will know what is on the inside. And I had to make a decision. He didn't force me. I said, Lord, you are the one who will see his life and protect him. And if something other than what I want to happen, I want you to know, I am not going to come back and complain and murmur. No, I will not do it. And there was pain, there was tears, but in the end, there was such joy and comfort knowing that Jesus once again became more important to me than my son and whatever I wanted. And that don't happen by memorizing Bible verses. That comes by making choices in the light of what you learn, what you hear. And Jesus very clearly makes it very, very real. You know the song we sing sometimes? My Jesus, I love thee, I know thou art mine. Remember that? For thee all the follies of sin I resign. You know, taking drugs and doing dumb things and hurting people, it's a bad thing for health and for your family. But more than anything else, Jesus, I don't want to do wrong things and sin because I love you. You know, there's a verse in the book of Psalms that says, search my heart, O God, and see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the paths of righteousness. In the Living Bible, that verse reads like this. Lord, please let me understand if there is anything in me that make you sad. Isn't that interesting? I remember when my little boy was 7 years old, something like that, in Dallas, Texas, and he did something naughty. And that evening when I came home from the office and my wife told me about it, and I called him and I said, Danny, I am so disappointed in you. Before I could finish my sentence, he took off running to the back of the house, got into the room and slammed the door, and we heard this wailing, crying out loud. My wife came from the kitchen and said, what did you do to him? I said, I didn't do nothing. She said, then how come he's screaming and crying? Well, you know, I went back to the room and opened the door and sat beside him and said, Danny, what happened? After a while, and he said, Daddy, you could have punished me, beat me, whatever you want to do, but I cannot hear you are disappointed in me. I just shocked me. I said, oh no. I said, never again I will ever say anything like that to my kids. But later the Lord will use that to teach me. When you walk away from me, when you do things that you know is not my wish, I am sad. And I don't want to disappoint the Lord. My son was deeply in pain because he felt he disappointed me. Do I want to disappoint my Lord? And my brothers and sisters, I ask you to take a close look at your love relationship with the Lord. And how do we measure that? You measure that by several ways. One, the amount of time you spend with him. And if you are not, don't feel guilty and kill yourself over this, but rather start today. And I recommend you get an alarm clock. Why alarm clock? Because all day long, you are so busy with so many things. And the alarm, you set it for 2 in the morning or so, so it will ring, it will wake you up. And you wash your face, you know, and then don't lay on the bed, but go to the living room, whatever, and kneel by the chair if you can, or sit and talk to the Lord. Read your word, get a world map, and pray over the things that is happening in the world today. And let these words be real for you, that Jesus said, can't you at least 1 hour wait with me? I'm in pain. I'm in pain for Bangladesh, Afghanistan, and China, and Eastern Europe, and the election in America, and what is happening in California. Can't you just wait 1 hour with me? I'm hurting. And what happened? Your earthen vessel, your body, your emotions, it once again becomes the means for Christ to incarnate and impact and bring change in your family, in our society, in our world. And this is the kind of thing you should learn. And I hope I have destroyed enough alarm clocks, I'm telling you. They are not my friends, but they help. And another thing I want you to think about is, do you ask the Lord what he wants to do with your time and with your resources. You got 2 weeks vacation. Yeah, the company gave you 2 weeks vacation and you're saving your money. But what about telling the Lord, Lord, what do you think about it? And the Lord may say, well, I'm glad you asked. I want you to send that money to take care of some children or some ministries or Bibles or whatever else and stay home and spend with me. Or he may tell you to go somewhere. You know what I'm saying? I mean, when was the last time you asked, Lord, what do you want me to do about anything? You know, it don't happen overnight. You know, it can become a second nature. When I'm reading an email, when I'm answering a telephone, it's automatic reflex in my head. During this conversation, often without me thinking, there's an endless loop turning in my head. Lord, what do you want me to say to this brother? How may I respond? What is it you are saying to me? And why? Because I'm learning to be close to him so that my life is not removed from him. It is a journey together with him. And Jesus said, your affection for me such that I am number one. And I pray that you will find that place in your life. By the way, your life will become much easier once love is a reason why you do things. Jacob, you know, got married. He wanted to marry Rachel. You know the story? Jacob was a crook, you know. He was a deceiver. And so he deceived his father and his brother. And he landed with the man who was twice the crook as he was. Laban. And so he falls in love with the girl, Rachel, and he wants to marry her. Laban says, all right, no problem, but 7 years you have to work. He worked 7 years like a slave, then he gets married, and next morning, I don't know how this thing works. He wakes up and finds he got the wrong girl. The girl he didn't like. So he gets mad. I would too. He says, what a creep, crook you are, Laban. I mean, that's not in the Bible. I just made it up. What have you done to me? He said, son, calm down, no problem. I think Laban was an Indian. Don't worry. You want Rachel? 7 more years you work. So he worked 7 more years. And you know what the Bible says? 14 years he worked like a slave. But it looked like just one day because he loved Rachel. And that is the reason why I'm encouraging you to take this serious what Jesus talked about. Secondly, if anyone want to come after me, Jesus said, let him deny himself and pick up his cross daily and come after me. Some people think self-denial is denying self. It's two different things. Self-denial is you give up, you know, drinking too much or going to movies or some pleasures of life or whatever else, you know, this and that. You know, a lot of non-Christians also do things like that. But denying self means complete submission to the Lordship of Christ. Some years ago, I read this poem somebody wrote, and I wrote it in the back of my Bible. I am seeking for one who will wait and watch for my beckoning hand, my eye, who will work in my manner the work I give, and the work I give not pass by. And oh, the joy that's brought to me when one such as this I can find, a man who will do all my will, who is set to study his master's mind. I am but a slave. I have no freedom of my own. I cannot choose the smallest thing, nor even my way. I am a slave, kept to do the bidding of my master. He can call me night or day. Were I a servant, I could claim wages, freedom sometimes anyway. But I was bought. Blood was the price my master paid for me. And I am now his slave and evermore will be. He takes me here. He takes me there. He tells me what to do. I just obey. That is all. And I trust him too. We as pragmatic people conditioned to run around like a chicken with a head cut off. Do this, do that, do that. I think, I mean, this Proposition 8 thing is coming up. I think, you know, our silence will send more people to hell and a nation to bondage. I think we must act, we must talk, we must do everything we can with all we have. But it all needs to be supported and based on something more deeper and real. That is seeking the Lord's ways and doing what He tells us to do. And denying self, how do you explain all that? Well, there's a lot of ways. I mean, for missionaries on the field I work with, like in Orissa, huge amount of crisis persecution. You know, I heard about, you know, a brother who was told by this extremist, radical, fundamentalist, you must deny your Christ and come back to the old faith. If not, we will destroy your house. They gave him the option. He knew already they are doing it to other people. He said, no, I can't. Even if you kill me, I will not deny my Christ. And the next day, they not only destroyed their house, but in the midst of open opposition, they brutally murdered his wife. And I was talking to a leader from Orissa, and I heard so many stories of people having to make a decision knowing their house, their belonging, their family members will be brutally abused and killed. And they must make a choice, loving Christ more than life itself. If all of us will make a choice to do that, I'm telling you, we can shake this world. You may go home today and throw out all the catalogs sitting in your bathroom, looking through pages after pages, dreaming and wishing what to buy for the Christmas and this present, that present. You will stop looking at the latest fashions and cars that is going by or adding more stuff. Listen, it is all bondage. Learn this. Please listen to me. You can do whatever you want for another 100 years. You will not know my Lord until you come to the place of understanding. You must die to yourself. And the measure in which you can say no to yourself, in the same measure you will understand it. This is not legalism. This is obedience and embracing the cross. And finally, Jesus said this. As the Father sent me, so send I you. 3.5 years he trained his disciples for one thing. Read Matthew's Gospel chapter 10. To go and live their life to be the means of redemption, to call a world to be reconciled with the Father. And every believer, whether you live in California or in Canada or in Germany or Russia, wherever, you need to know this. 100 years from now, you are not going to live in your house here, drive the car, wear those clothes and the jewelries. You are not going to be living with all the talks from other people. You are a great guy. You are wonderful. Opinions from other people. Honor from other people. Please believe me. It's all for nothing. But as you stand before the throne, you want to look back over your life on earth. Not as someone who made so much money and got the best degrees and had the biggest house, but rather someone who walked on a lonely road with sacrifice and suffering and less of material things. Why? You exchange all for the sake of 2 billion people that do not know Christ, that they may come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. 180 million child laborers living in India alone. Over 100,000 children living in the street, on the streets of Calcutta and Bombay, not knowing who their parents are. Afghanistan is 17 million people with less than 500 Christians in the whole country. Think about the reality of the lost world. We are consumed about something happening around us in America. And you know, this meltdown of the dollar or whatever may be the way God is going to call us to come to the place that we can have everything without any of this thing if we know Jesus and be His completely. I was born in a home where I have 5 other brothers. I'm the youngest in the family. My father passed away. He was a believer in 1974. And I was in seminary in Dallas when that happened. And I had the privilege to grow up in this home where my mother especially was a very devout Christian. Very simple woman. She never went to college, university, and she lived in the village. But she loved the Lord with all her heart. Every morning she would wake up 3-4 in the morning and spend a couple hours on her knees in prayer before she wake up the family for family prayer. As I was growing up as a tiny boy, I heard my mother repeating this Bible verse continually. Psalm 73 verse 25. Whom have I in heaven but you, and on earth I desire no one and nothing beside you. I thought, what is wrong with my mother? I never saw her reading any other book. All she had was the Bible. But we all knew she had this incredible relationship with the Lord. One of her prayers was that one of her 6 boys will go as a missionary to serve God. And all my brothers, one by one, they went to farming and business and all that. And she tells, when I was born and growing up, timid, shy, skinny, withdrawn, she kind of lost her hope. She decided to fast and pray for every Friday for 3.5 years, solid fast, one prayer request. Lord, please call one of my son to serve you. And she never told this to anyone. When I finished my high school, I felt the Lord was calling me. By the way, when I was 8 years old, my mother led me to the Lord. And when I finished my high school, I told my parents, if they allow me, I'd like to go to North India to serve the Lord. Before I could finish my sentence, my mother jumped up and said, go! I thought I was an accident or she hated me. For she never told what she was praying for. And years later, I found out the whole story. In 1990, I was on the way to Seoul, Korea. When I reached Bombay, I heard my mother was taken ill at the age of 84 with some heart problems. She never been hardly sick. And that weekend, of course, I canceled my trip. That weekend, my mother passed away. The saddest day of my life. For days, I cried. She was my best friend and prayer partner. And after the funeral, my brothers and I met to talk about our mother. And one of my brothers asked the question, how much money did our mother leave in the bank? Well, the truth was, after our father died, and my mother becomes the boss, she is everything, and her sons would give her money, whatever she wanted or she didn't want it. And so we all knew she got all this money, but we never saw her spending any money. So we assumed, everybody thought she must be keeping it in the bank. Answering the question, one of my brothers said, he pulled out this old notebook. He said, I found this under the pillow of our mother's bed. And he flipped the pages. And he said, well, this page after page, names of young people in Bible schools, missionaries on the mission field, and against their names, the amount of money she was sending month after month. But she never told this to anyone. The moment he said that, I broke down crying. Not because there was no money in the bank. 2 years prior to that, I was in India when I saw my mother wearing a blouse that torn from here to here, stitched by hand like Mickey Mouse job. And I was very angry, literally. I was furious. I said, Mother, what got into your head? This madness. Don't you know what our people in the community will think about your sons? You are putting shame on our head and cowdung on our face. Those are very difficult, serious statements. And preachers can get mad sometimes, and I was. And my mother, after hearing all my mighty speech and see how angry I was, very calm, very sweet, incredible smile, she said, my little boy, you don't understand. Someday you will understand. Now sitting in the room, it was as though my mother walked back into the room, put her arms around me, whispering in my ear, my son, now you know the rest of the story. I could have bought a new dress every month. Jewelry, lived like any of my friends. But I chose to live with little. I didn't want to live like anybody else. To spend everything I can to preach the gospel, to reach the lost world. But that is not the end of the story. The will she left with us. When I'm dead and gone, the only thing I will leave behind is my earrings, my wedding ring, and the gold chain my husband gave me at the age of 19 when he married me. I want you to sell these items and give the money to preach the gospel among people that never heard my Jesus name. I want to meet them also in heaven. Let me ask you, you think my mother is sitting with Jesus now, grieving over not buying new dresses and diamond rings and having all the fashions and everybody else lived for? I tell you, she lived like a poor, broken woman in a small village, although she had all this money given to her. It was a choice she made, not because somebody told her, forced her, because she loved her master. And that made her to hurt and ache for a world that is going to hell. Some of you must go home and go through your house and ask Jesus to walk with you, take an inventory of all the stuff you live with. Not out of guilt and condemnation, but please remember, someday, you'll remember my words. And now, if you seek the Lord, you will find Jesus to be more sweeter and precious than all the stuff everybody is talking about. And there's nothing you can do that is too much because you love him. And may the Lord speak to us. And I encourage you to pursue the Lord. It's worth pursuing him. Amen.